Spoken of another day. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. You all know that God ceased from his work, right? On which day did he? On the sixth day. He rested on the seventh day. So he stopped on the sixth. after he said everything was finished. Now why you all think God went and rest on the seventh day? So you all don't listen to the devotion.
Because he was done.
You also don't listen to the devotion.
Because he finished with
God. Because he was tired, right?
No, he was
tired. Huh?
He was tired. Be tired.
Well, it said he went and rest.
No, he's finished. The work was completed.
Well, he's finished, so he went and rest.
It's finished. He completed the work. He don't have anything to do again.
All right, to the Genesis chapter 2. To the Genesis chapter 2. So you tell him that God was not tired.
No, he was.
He just rest.
He's not a human being.
Oh, he's not a human being. Okay. Genesis chapter 2, verses 1, 2, and 3. Genesis 2, verses 1, 2, and 3. When the writer Hebrew entered into chapter 3 and 4, what he started to really explain to us and the believers and all who he was writing to was about this thing called rest. And he was talking about the Hebrews who were taken out of Egypt. And when they came out of Egypt, they were supposed to just take a few days and cross over into the promised land. But when they got to the promised land area and sent the spies over to go and see what happened, what did they meet on the other side?
Giants.
So these 12 spies got afraid. 10 come back really scared out of the winds and decided we're not going over here because there's some big giants over there and we won't get tired. At the same time, God is in their presence literally. He's like right there with them, looking at them, listening to them. He's a cloud and a pillar. So two decided that they could go. So you know what God did? God made sure that all who didn't believe died. Because once you don't believe, you won't get to enter into his rest. And those who believe got to enter into his rest. So unbelief was the cause why they couldn't enter into his rest. Now the same rest word the writer in Hebrews talking about here is justification, which in Romans 5:1 is what? Having peace with God through
Jesus
Christ. That's the only way you can have peace with God. So the justification now leads to what? Salvation. Which is the whole purpose why you all come into church. Who not here for salvation? Who? That wasn't it. You just come to get blessed. You come so that you will get a job, money will go up in the bank, you will build a house. Who is that and ain't get saved yet? Who ain't get saved? Okay, what? Thank you, all of them. So it was about the rest he writing Hebrew was talking about when he went and he said that if Jesus didn't give them rest, which means here at this point in time, he was disclosing to all of them that even from that point in time, is Jesus who was responsible for you being saved.
Amen.
Right? So salvation comes by Jesus Christ, you know, and conviction is by the Holy Ghost. Jesus saves, write it down, and the Holy Spirit convicts. It's two different things that takes place there. Jesus is who saves, and the Holy Spirit convicts. Oh, everybody there, Genesis chapter 2 now? From verses 1, it says this. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them, which is that he's talking about the universe, the all the stars, and all the other moons, and all the other suns, and the entire universe he created. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. So then God still wasn't tired. Huh? Well, he was not tired because he is God. God, the rest that they're talking about here means to withdraw from working. So he withdrew from working and rested. And it's the same application the writer in Hebrew is making. He's telling them that those who didn't believe didn't get to enter the promised land. So rest is achieved by ceasing from works. You all understand what I'm just saying?
Amen.
Once you continue to work, it means that you cannot rest. Irregardless of what you're doing, for you to rest, you gotta cease from work. So it applies now to this understanding that if you cease from work and you are only resting, which means that it is nothing physical that is taking place for you to rest. You have to stop from that. So anybody who thinks that they gotta work will never enter into the
rest. Amen.
And that's what salvation is about. So salvation was shown from the beginning of the world. In chapter 2 here, when God rested on the seventh day. You get it?
Yes.
Say amen.
Amen. Amen.
So the new salvation that I sent out, devotion that I sent out there since Thursday for you lovely people who have been listening, first begins with a definition of what salvation or saved means. Now, salvation or saved means that you are removed from either impending, you understand, or imminent danger. You get it? The danger is present. It's prevalent. That danger is condemnation. Just as we who are saved receive eternal life, who is not saved will receive eternal condemnation. So that's the imminent danger. It is there. Anybody who dies right now who haven't believed in Jesus Christ as Lord, going to receive that condemnation. A lot of people outside here think that there are so many gods and there's this one God, and this God is over all the other faiths and religions, which is absolutely madness, because Jesus is an exclusive God.
Amen.
He says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and nobody can get into him except through me.
Amen.
So yeah, they might believe that they have one God, and that might work for quite a lot of people even right now. But you see, the day that their breath leaves their body, they are going to burn for an eternity. So that's what salvation is about. Salvation is removing you from that imminent danger. So listen, if that's the definition of being saved, if that's the definition of being saved, and you think that that danger is still present, what does that mean? You're not saved.
It's doubting, no doubt.
You just understand that? Anytime you think that the danger is still present, which means that what happened on the cross
wasn't enough
and worked for you.
Correct.
Amen.
You get me? Okay. So the definition itself for salvation, what it means itself, is the same proof that people use to say that we're not saved. Because they're saying that something they do could affect what he did. Which means that what he do and remove you from the imminent danger that was there, it's still in front of you. Because if it is still scaring you, it means that you ain't ready to believe. Not ain't ready to believe, you ain't believe. So the definition itself proves or disproves who says anything different to what God say that I have to cease from my will to rest. You get it? So, Romans 5:1, which we just went through there, says that being justified
by faith.
Look at my people.
Being justified.
We have found peace with God through
faith.
Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Are we sure about that? Justification is through Jesus Christ. And what he did on the cross. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1 to 4 says what? Mom, the gospel. Yeah, we can take it like that because it can be plenty mumbling. 1 Corinthians 15 presents to us the gospel. Where's Paul coming to them? He said, more of a brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, where you stand, where you are saved. If you believe that Christ what?
Died.
Rose, buried and was rose again, all according to the
scriptures.
So the gospel is one thing in which Paul continuously says, that's all I preach. And that's the game changer. Because if you get that, then you see in Christ Jesus. If you get that, then you will realize that the gospel preaching from since Genesis chapter 1 in the beginning.
Amen.
If you get that, then everything else will open up for you. And if you get that, then you're going to live a life that suits what it is you say again. Because then you get to realize, but wait, man, does Jesus really do this thing for me? 1 Corinthians 6:20. It says what? Ye, come on, are bought with ye
Christ.
You bought in on your purchase, you are the purchased possession. Until the day of redemption. You can't redeem unless you fully pay for it. You get me?
Amen.
So if you didn't fully pay for it, we couldn't be the purchased possession to be redeemed.
Amen.
In no time, God asks anybody to pay for it for themselves. Okay, somebody was asking, man. These Israelites, these Hebrews who come out of Egypt, God literally with them, right? Am I wrong? God is literally with them. In the night, he's what? A pillar of fire, the Bible says. He's there with them. In the day, he's what? A cloud. So he's there. They are literally seeing. If they move left, they see the cloud move left. If they move right, they see the cloud move right. If they're going up, the fire going up. They're coming down, the fire coming down. So he is literally with them there. Paul tells us in Corinthians that that was Jesus who was with them. With them all the time. Now, he just destroyed Egypt with 10 plagues. Remember last week I was telling you all that it had two magicians in Egypt. Their names were Jannes and Jambres. So those were the two witchcraft men who were withstanding who the Bible says Moses and Aaron, right? So everything that Moses and Aaron do, Jannes and Jambres do it back. So everything they do, they do it back. Which I told you about like your lifestyle here right now. Every time we fix something for you inside of here, as they walk outside the devil, sliver. So nothing ain't working until God do something what the devil can do. You get it? So when God destroy Egypt now, we come and he do our next thing what they could do, we come and he open the sea upon the cross. And then they doubt if God could have given any promise, huh? What's the reason why they doubted? Don't try to answer. Because they were believing in their own capabilities if we could have done it. And not if God was able to do it. You get it?
Amen.
So if you're believing in your capabilities, you will always have doubt believers in Christ Jesus. You get it? Once you try to figure out if you could do it, it go on that in itself telling you that you're doubting. And that's the epitome, the foundation of why things ain't getting done in your life, because that ain't faith. Faith relies on what God do, not what you do. You okay with this? So all the works that God do is what, you remember when I said 11:1:1? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of what?
Things unseen.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for you. The substance, what is made up in your mind, what is made up of what God did. During the whole chapter on faith, you see them talk about anything or anybody other than God do? No. So all these examples is witness you are the base what God can do for you on.
Amen.
You get it?
Yes.
The things that happen to us in this life, the miracles, the upliftment, the edification, the fruitfulness, all the blessings that we have in this life, it's not based on anything we doing, it's on the past things that the big God already done. So if we believe that he did that, it's not nothing he ain't gonna do for you.
Amen.
And that's where your faith gonna be. But if your faith is planted in knowing, then how it gonna work for you? So you gotta rehearse these things, and these things gotta be in you. In you. Because that's what you're basing on everything else getting done. What he already did. That's what constitutes the whole makeup of the faith, into the hope, into the evidence of things not seen materializing in your life. You get me? salvation. Same way. It's about what God do.
Amen.
Not about what you do. Good?
Amen.
So, then I spoke to you all about Matthew 16, 18 and Matthew 16, 21. Matthew 16, 18, Jesus is at Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi is where they call the gates of hell, which still exists today, which is a cave that they cannot measure the depths at the bottom of. It's there. So they say, the Romans believe that the gates of hell exist there because they take all the demons that they use and conjure up and call gods to come out of there. So Jesus stands at the gates of Caesarea Philippi and he looks at his 12 men and he says, who do men say that I am? And while he's standing there asking this question, they are answering and all kind of things they say. You're a prophet? People think that's a big up answer. They say, you a priest. You was this, you was that. The best captain you will until one man answer and say, you see, you're the son of the living God. Jesus says, he said, flesh and blood could not reveal that to you.
Amen.
Only the Holy Ghost could have revealed that to you.
Amen.
You understand? Man? And in verse 21 now, the Bible comes and says, Matthew, because he said, from that time, yeah, from that time, Jesus began to preach and to teach and to tell them that he was going to die, be buried, and raised again after the third day. The gospel.
Amen.
He introduced to them, which is the catalyst of what saves. The biggest thing God ever do was to bring back God from the dead and prove that he is God. You get me? So that's why you had to base your faith on. Because if you could believe that, it had nothing that God ain't gonna do for you if you really exercise that faith. You could move the mountains that you want to move right now and resurrect the things that you thought was dead. Did you hear what I'm telling you? No? And the way that you thought it did not away, you could see it to happen and the sea going on open for you to cross whatever situation you are in. It's about that, you know. Waking up this fear that lays dormant within your life, because every time you think of doing something, you start to study about your capabilities. It's not about you, believer. You in a big, you in the big God, you know. So then it can't be about you. Don't separate yourself from what is work for you. And decide to study it. We going and fight giants. I ain't got to fight no giant. God going and fight that giant for me. You feel me? I ain't got to worry about tomorrow. God don't see about my tomorrow today. And every opportunity I get to drop low is for me to reach more Jesus. So don't take these situations that life is handing and feel like it's nothing that's supposed to cause depression, supposed to move you away from God, supposed to move you away from the assembling of the saints to cause it to pray in a tight situation. We say, you need the physician, I won't show up. I'm coming.
Amen.
He said, those who sick is them who need the physician, act like you need Jesus, man.
Amen.
You gotta act like it. You get me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. To the tree of your goodness, not to the devotion.
Amen.
So then, from Matthew 16, 21, I spoke to you all about Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 9. Let's write it down. There's about 21 scriptures, right? Which I'm not really going to try. I said, well, I'll take a couple hours. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. Which some of you all should have already learned. Because it says this, for by grace are ye saved through faith. For by grace are ye saved through faith. It is the
gift
of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. God ain't giving nobody the opportunity to try to save themselves.
Amen.
Because somebody reached in heaven and said, I do this.
Yes.
So he's not giving anybody the opportunity to boast. So if nothing you do it can qualify you, then nothing you do can disqualify it. You get it? It has no bearing on your saving. He said, for by grace are you saved, you know. True faith. It is the gift of God, not of works. Let's say much boast. So that's the reason why it can only happen by believing in Christ Jesus. So that man, just to say, we don't understand the scriptures that are sent there to protect us. We think it's something that is sent there to obstruct us. So when he said that I'm getting the opportunity to boast, it's because he ain't really trying to beat you down. He's trying to raise you up and tell you that nothing you could do could tamper with your own salvation.
Amen.
You get it? So sometimes in everything, just like dropping low, you think that you think working against it, you think that really come out there to work for you. But you, with your limited space mind, thinking that every time the situation comes and looking negative, that something said there to break you down, that's the time God's ready to lift you up.
Amen.
How y'all feeling this morning, I tell you that? Yeah, because some situations happen in my life. And some situations must happen in your life, and all the time you think, well, what I do, boy, what I this, boy, what I do to get into the situation, you get into God put you there so he could pull you out. And prove his hand in your life.
Yes, sir.
And make something look different. Something that was looking real dark and dismal, he going to make it look glittery and shiny and gold. Because that's the God you serve. It's not our God, and listen, it's our God if you diligently seek him, he's going to reward. Going to reward. Y'all gonna see people up in here this morning. Y'all gonna tell last night. It's alright. Right? From Ephesians 2 and 9, Romans 1:16. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God and the salvation. Let me hear that again from everybody. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God and the salvation. 1:16, Romans 1:16. For the Jew first, and then to the?
So to the Greek.
To the Greek. Why he said it was available to them first?
Because the oracles came through.
And then it come to us after, the Gentiles. Don't mind one, so you might be some Jews not up over there, we never know. From that, you know, I started to speak to you all about the three factors that the church needs to focus on, or those who are in the position to focus on, for those who are in the congregation and the membership. Colossians 1:9. Hear what Paul says. It's about making sure that you all gain the knowledge, that you all gain the wisdom, somebody like the knowing boy, and that we make sure and we fill you all with spiritual understanding. You all hear that? Knowledge, wisdom, and the spiritual understanding. What kind of understanding?
Spiritual
understanding. Because the spiritual understanding is going to change your physical situation. That's why if you have a problem when it comes to us, what we're going to tell you about is the word of God. And it's the word of God that's going to change, because the spiritual understanding is going to change your physical situation. So once you reach in for the spiritual tool, then your physical problem go get fixed. You okay now?
Amen.
No, you can't be reaching for the spiritual tool and still working on physical problem. You're defeating the purpose. Which means that if you're reaching for a spiritual tool, then you can't be operating derelict in the comfort. You get what I'm saying? Let me work for you. Everybody there?
Yeah.
For it to work for you, you have to also align to walking in the spirit. So you will fulfill the lust of the flesh. What it does here is what? It restricts anything from continuing in the state of the flesh. He says, walk in the spirit so you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So when you are in the spirit, using a spiritual application, spiritual tools, then it restricts anything from going through any physical. It cannot take place. You put a stop to it. So everything that come and remains there in your power. By what? Behavior. Behavior alone. So from there, Romans 4:4. And Romans 4:4 comes and talks about debt. So Paul says, he who works, their reward is not of grace, it is of debt. And God ain't no man debtor. So if you're working, then it's not faith. You working debt. You say God owe you. If you're doing what you're doing, God don't owe you to save you. Salvation coming by belief.
Amen.
You can't work enough to build it up that he owe you to save you.
Amen.
What are you doing in this? What are you going to do in this life? What could you do in this life that you could repay a debt to pay for this? This thing where you're valuing so much, what are you going to do to pay for it? Have you ever seen an amount in the scriptures that the value is to pay for your life? But we know the amount and the value, the amount and the value is Jesus Christ. You can't pay, he can't pay for anything. So he said, whoever is working, that reward is debt. Debt is condemnation. You get me?
Amen.
1 Corinthians 6:20, we covered that just now. You are bought with a price. 1 John 2:2. These verses will help you out to fully understand 6:20. That is, we went over that before just now. We are bought with a price. This one here now is 1 John 2:2. These verses will help you all to be able to fully explain to other people. If you look it over here, listen to the devotion once again, yeah? Eventually it will soak in like one of the songs you'll be listening to. And you'll be able to sing it out. You know what I mean? And tell people about Jesus. So 1 John 2:2 says what? Here's the what? Propitiation. This is propitiation. For what?
For us,
you know,
only for us.
I want to, your body is propitiation for our sins. Be churches. Touch us. You ain't going God for nothing. They ain't listening. This is why Paul tell them about salvation. He said, for that reason, you had to glorify God in your body, you know, because you ain't got nothing you're going for no more. You ain't have nothing you're waiting for. God ain't going to do you anything for any sin you do. You're paying for that here. So if you want to pay for it here, if you want to live your rest life here, go ahead. That is, you know, something that's wrong with that. Anything wrong with that? If you're living on you want to live? Eh? That's on you. That's on you. Paul said all things. Yeah, Paul. But Paul tell him that in the same chapter 6. He said, I can do what I wanted. He said, all things are expedient unto me. I can do anything I want. He said, but all things don't profit me. Believe in Christ Jesus. That's the thing you ought to consider. It's not the fact that, yeah, God pay all sin for you, you know, and you can live where you want to live, you know. It doesn't profit you. And that's the bad thing about it. So instead of spending your time where things not profiting, but then spend your time where things profiting you.
Amen.
So it leaves it up to us again. Their free will, you know, God never interfere with us. He never interfere with us. Just like with the cross. You get it? Free will. You can do whatever it is you want. But you ain't gonna profit it. So what is this here, I don't know? The unprofitable thing or the profitable thing?
Profitable.
Don't lie to yourself here this morning. I just tell you, don't lie to yourself. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 to 14. Come, I want to read this one with me. Because marrying straight to Corinthians 6, 20. Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians. I would have been on the right side all the time. I would not get it wrong. They would not put me on the track. I was buying Ephesians. Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. I want to read this one. Everybody? in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the what? The gospel of your salvation, in whom also that what
believe. Conceived
with
the Holy Spirit of Christ.
So the first thing you do was what? Hear. You all see there?
Yeah.
The first thing you do is hear. You heard the word of truth, which is the gospel of salvation.
Yeah.
The next thing you do is what?
Believe.
Believe. So as soon as you hear, then you believe. And when you believe, what takes place?
Sealed.
Come on, let it go. Yeah,
amen.
You sealed him.
Amen.
You can't break that seal.
Amen.
You can't tamper with it.
Oh.
Neither anything the enemy does. Neither anything anybody tell you. Nothing can tamper with the seal that you have been sealed with because you believe.
Amen.
He said, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the what?
The redemption of the purchased possession under the grace of his glory.
The redemption of the purchased possession, a little bit. A sharp like that.
Yes.
Until I seal, until I am the purchased possession, and I said, let's serve you this business. Are you the purchased possession?
Yes.
I am sealed until the day of redemption and until Christ comes to me.
Yes.
Nothing can happen.
Yes.
Nothing can happen. They give me no limited time with my salvation and don't tell me anything that if this happened and this happened. They say until that day comes.
Amen.
I am the purchased possession until the day of redemption.
Hallelujah.
That they had to come.
Amen.
I will come now, man, because I fear you look like you're worried about some bills.
Oh my God.
And you're worried about some things taking place tomorrow. Come, Jesus, come.
Amen.
Come, Jesus, come.
Right now.
Yeah, the tunnel roll outside there right now. Oh, let's tell that church to stay, but I leave it all over here. Boom, 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 my God. I'm going. You know, I was thinking about this game, me jumping back out there and I said, but I'm going to make me jumping back out. The army will be heavy.
Really?
Yeah. Brother, so the few men, all of them come on, doing all the rewards, so we will be up on the front line. Right? We fight them first. You gotta fight first now for your families, as he heads. You gotta fight first now because you are men. Amen.
Amen.
So from Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, Hebrews 1, 3, which you don't have to go there because what it's saying is that God is the image of Christ. Christ is the image of God. And here was the important line in that verse. When they talk about sins, they say he by himself
purged.
You hear that? The Bible says he singularized the propitiation in 1 John. Singular. It comes up in Hebrews 1, 3 and say, he by himself purged. How much is that?
One.
Singular again. So if he purged all sin, and they don't leave all that. If he purged all sin, how you with your meager self, fast enough to jump up with that? You're out of place.
Out of place, girl.
Out of order. Right now, like, don't you just hit the
floor? Hey!
he said, he by himself purged you. You cannot stand with the mighty God.
Amen.
You can't do it.
Who are you?
Yeah. And if we take anything like that or decide to act like that, then we really out of order as mega human beings. You can't even fly. If you feel to fly right now, fly! Go up there and beat your chest. It's only God, he said, he by himself purged. After he by himself purged all of our sins. Christ Jesus, it is the Lord. Hebrews 2:14. Singular business again. Hebrews 2:14. Somebody don't get it already. It says this. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, He also himself, yes, it is singular. He also himself, and making sure you are safe, likewise took part of the same. He, God, Christ, took on the same as the children, flesh and blood. And through death he might destroy him. Who is destroying? He, singular. Might destroy who? Him. Let me hear that again. Him what? That had the power of death. That is the devil. If you think that you could do anything, then you're gonna fight the devil yourself. But guess what? Christ done destroyed that already. You know what Jesus said in the book of Luke? He said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Jesus beat the chest with that devil. So this study you take now, the field could fight now. I watch it fall down. I watch it fall out of heaven. So if you in this mighty Christ, what mighty fear you could have?
Jesus.
You can't no fear. You in a mighty, mighty God. He said, watch that fall out of heaven. That could interfere with you. Huh? He said, don't destroy that death already. That is the devil. Amen?
Yes.
You look like you're scared. Don't be afraid. Revelation 12, 11. Yeah, I'm going to go there. As I said, I'm trying to speak up for you guys. Revelation 12, 11. Now, a lot of people just talk this scripture and read out the context and say it's by the word of the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. It's not by your testimony. Don't come to tell nobody about how your oil stretch and your... There are all kind of things that come to tell people about testimony here. That's not the testimony the Bible is talking about. That's not what saved you.
Amen.
He said they love not their lives to death. They love not their lives to death. And they will save by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. By what Jesus do and what you believe. The blood of the Lamb is what Jesus do. And by the word of your testimony, it's by what you believe.
Amen.
You get it?
Amen.
Your testimony is that Christ paid the price for me.
Amen.
You get it? He paid the price. And if you let that be your testimony, let me tell you something. Some of you are going to walk through some situations tomorrow. When you're going in there, I know some might be bold enough to say it. And if you ain't bold enough to say it, just say it when you cross the church over where you're going. That's the doorway. Christ paid the price for me and everything at the subdued. When you announce that to all the principalities that Christ paid the price for me, you are an overcomer.
Amen.
You get me? You get me? Everybody still there? We still there?
Yes.
Alright, cool. So after Revelation, we have Romans 11:29. You're about to look at here where it's saying. I memorize these things for your behalf. It says that the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. Yeah? Yeah, the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. If I give something to you, I'm not going to take it back. Simple like that. You get me? So if God decides to bless you, you ain't losing that blessing at all. And if he give you salvation, if he said give you Jesus to pay the price on the cross for you, God don't change his mind. He don't change his mind. If God changes his mind, then it interferes with the omniscience of God. It's saying that he doesn't know everything. So he didn't know in the morning you're going to do something stupid. And in the evening you're going to try to fix it, and the next day you do something stupid again. So holy God, with that big eraser, rubbing off in him, writing back up. Rubbing off in him, writing back up.
Makes no sense.
You interfere with God's omniscience, man. The gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. Write that down. Because somebody will tell you something, you know, that's what you're going to tell them. Don't argue with people, you know. Just give them scriptures and you leave. Let me tell you something. Who had to go to hell? Go into heaven. None of you can stop that. Don't argue with nobody. Present a little one, two scriptures. That's why I want you to know some of the scriptures, so you might be able to say something that may change somebody else, may help somebody else to see the light. You get me? It's not like you can spoon feed it in that, because I know all around some unbelievers. I'm sure about that. But in some heavy fights. But what God do in your book, that it comes in no repentance, right? Matthew 3:11 and Acts 1:5. Matthew 3:11 is John telling them about two baptisms. He said, I truly baptize you with water. He said, but he that cometh after me will baptize you. He said, what's that? John said, I truly baptize you with water. He said, but he who coming after me going to baptize you in fire and in Holy Ghost. He said, I ain't even worthy. Catch up. John said, I can baptize you unto repentance, and that ain't nothing normal. You understand that? John put himself in a position of authority there. He said, I can baptize him in water unto repentance, unto changing all things you're doing. He said, but you see who coming after me?
Fire.
He said, he baptized him with fire and the Holy Ghost him. He said, I can't even bend down to unloose the man's sandals. Who coming after me? When Jesus shot behind John, so John shot. John said, I'm not baptizing you. Jesus said, let it be so for now, Lord. Baptize him. Yeah. John didn't want to baptize him. When John seen John frightened, John scared. John said, look him coming there. They said, who is this? Look him coming there. When he reached John, John said, I can't wait till him. Jesus said, let him. He said, I can't baptize. He said, let it be so for now.
No.
At this point, you baptize me. And as soon as the dipping man, you come back out of the water, they said, the Holy Spirit comes down on him like a son. And prove that he is who he said he is. Because he turned us at the talk. He turned us at the talk. He said, this is my beloved son. And whom I am well pleased. Do as he say. The sky started to talk to mankind as soon as the dipping man bring him out. You hear? You know when they went to pick him up, when they went to lock him up to crucify him. And Judas come and kiss him. Because they didn't know who he was, right?
Yeah.
You don't know that they didn't identify him, eh? They didn't know who he was.
No.
All the time Jesus moving around doing miracles, all kind of things. They want to kill him, that warrant out for him. They pay a man to find him. They didn't know who he is or he looked. Judas had to tell him, man, I go and kiss. So when Judas kiss him, the army down there ready to lock him up in. So when Judas done kiss him, he bust out the crowd, so he says me. The Bible said everybody fall down on the ground. When he step out. He said, if I want him, he said, I have legions and angels dealing with other
ready.
You get me? That is the man. So he just showed him a glimpse of the power and he just come out from the crowd and he says to me. They said all the soldier, priest, everything was in front of him, dropped down on the ground, you know. And imagine he was operating in the flesh at that point.
Watch this when
he comes. And they can't stand up before him at all. He let them lock him up.
Yes.
To go and pay a price
for us.
You know why you're being generous? You know why you're being generous? Because the Holy Spirit confirmed to you that even if you try to believe it right now, it can't happen. Your mind will not conceive doubt. You can't conceive doubt. You know why? Because you're saved. Holy Ghost washed and baptized.
Amen.
You properly saved. Yeah, you so saved that you yourself can't convince yourself in the morning that you could go to heaven.
No, not at all.
You can't be convinced, you can't be trying to unbelieve right now. But if you try to and your mind not letting you process unbelief. You realize that?
Yes.
That's where your mind is, because the Holy Spirit is who working that, and otherwise you would have physically be able to determine, I am an unbeliever, I cannot believe, but the Holy Ghost lock you in a position there. That is one thing you can see that Jesus is your faith.
Yeah.
You can't even move. You can't move.
Fully persuaded.
So in Acts now chapter 1:5, Jesus come and tell him again, he said, John baptized you with water. He said, but not many days hence, you all shall be baptized by the fire and the Holy Ghost. So they went waiting. They're waiting in the book of Acts now for this Holy Ghost. They're waiting for the Holy Ghost. Not they're waiting for the Holy Ghost. They were thought he was going to walk to the door. I thought Jesus coming. The Holy Ghost brought in the room, the Bible said, as the sound of a mighty rushing wind. The Holy Spirit was not windy. I don't know where people get that from. The Holy Spirit come with a song, the Bible said, that the room started following that noise like,
Jesus.
And enter into that room, the same man start to talk in tongues and fire. You hear what I'm saying? They said everybody who was in Jerusalem hear the gospel in their own tongue. They had people from Partizan, from Rome, from Italy, you name it, all people was all over. And they heard it in their own tongue. Nobody didn't have to talk their language, they hear it. Because there's one Holy Ghost talking to one spirit. So everybody had to get the same information, regardless of where you're from. You get me? But it's all about Jesus alone.
Yes,
nobody else. So what's that? The sad man going up in the sky, because you know when he went up in the book of Acts, everybody was watching. You all know that, right? Listen to me now. You all be reading the scripture and then catching that eyewitness accounts. What did he get in?
Yes.
Eyewitness accounts. So in the book Acts, after Jesus telling him, he said, not many days hence, he's looking to go up. So the Bible says he starts to go up. So everybody down here now, just like all of them, just watching them float up, going up in the sky here. Wait, hang up. They start to feel sad. What are you feeling sad about? What are you feeling sad about? Some of them want to go, and some of them want to stay. So here two men who was there. Wait, hang 2 minutes. They said Elijah and Moses. They said, ye men of Galilee, why are you standing here? They said, the same way you go is the same way you come back.
Amen.
This is your worry about. It's not a dead God.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's a living God. Just so we go up in the clouds, just so he's coming back for you.
Amen.
Purchase possession, you know. Them is mine, I coming for them. Yes, I coming for them. Who you ever leave the church somewhere and hear something going on them, but I going for them, like my church, I going.
Yes.
You hear something wrap the tape with a water cut off in the school, you ready to run down there. Jesus coming for you.
Amen.
And he's coming soon.
Amen.
Now, I just have verses here, these verses here. Straightly tell you that salvation is by believing, and when you believe, you will get eternal life. John 6:47, 1 John 5:13.
John 6:47.
As Jesus, he said, verily, verily, he that believeth in me shall have everlasting life. Then in 1 John 5:13, you all are writing on the scripture, you all are writing the scripture, just the verses. 1 John 5:13, Romans 8:15-16, and those two I want you all to follow me and read. You ready? You look ready. And hear what he said. Everybody had to read this one. This is the scripture that is excited.
Romans 8:15-16.
Everybody had to read it. If you didn't read it, diligently listen to it. It's almost time for letting go. Ready?
Yeah.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. You have not received that. But ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and all again, God praise the name. That is confirmation. The spirit They say people go to confirmation class. If you don't confirmation class, and as soon as you believe, you don't take the class and pass away.
Amen.
You confirm by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Bible says the Spirit is telling you. No man will tell me that I confirm.
Amen.
The Spirit is telling you, you confirm. How he does know that you're confirmed is because you sure God is your Father.
Yes, Lord.
Abba Father, listen. So we cry that to him by adoption. You hear me?
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Luke 16, 31, right now. We almost done. Abraham is sitting in paradise, and they bring up this rich boy. He lived his life how he wanted to live his life. So they ended up on the outside of paradise. Paradise existed before heaven, okay? Was open to you guys. You all understand that?
Yes.
Paradise existed before heaven was open to mankind. There was this place, an in-between place. So it would have housed those who were good and those who were bad. And they could not cross. There was a gulf between them. So there is this young man who went up there, and when he realized how hot hell really could be, he started to beg for mercy, and he pleaded with everybody. So he asked Abraham now, because he checked in Abraham, he said, no, he next said it, God, for the nature and the legs cross. And he said, let me send a message to my brothers and them, so that they may go up where I is. You know what Abraham told him? He said, they have the prophets. He said, they have Moses. He said, let them listen to death. Yes. All you understand what I mean?
Yes.
Listen to the word of God.
Amen.
Yes. Listen to the word of God. He said, them are the prophets and they have Moses. They have Moses, all the prophets and them. Which means that they're talking about Christ from ever since the beginning. He said, though one come back from the dead, they will not believe. You hear what Abraham tell them? You know why? All they get at the end is all and only about the resurrection. And there's only one coming back from the dead for them to believe him, and it's Christ Jesus. Tell them, he said, Jesus himself come back. Let me see that go down. So if you in the place of belief right now, you in the Abraham place. You're up there. It's all about Jesus. Look, Abraham gonna talk about anything, he said, don't one come back. One singular come back from the dead. He said, them still air going and believe. Unbelief is with them dealing with. That's all? Because it's all about only Jesus.
Alright.
Nothing else. Imagine up there, we're wrapping up now. You close up your books and tell me. But what about the tell you here is about the rest, which I was explaining before. Israel was bad from the rest. Jude 5 says they were bad because of unbelief. They could not cross. The writer in Hebrew takes us back to Genesis chapter 2 to show them that God rested on the seventh day, but he didn't pick up what he was talking about. So I explained to you all earlier there that you have to cease from work to receive the rest. Which means that you can't be working to try to be saved. The rest is justification and salvation. So in Psalm 95, verse 7, you know, David now writing, come and talk about another day of rest. David said, today, if they will hear my voice, harden not your heart, as those who perished in the wilderness. Which is the example. Let me tell you something here this morning. The only reason why some things immaterialize for you as yet is because of your own unbelief. You hear what I'm saying? Because you ain't believe that it's God who was supposed to do it. You still thinking that it's about what you could do. I'll be changing that this morning because Lord, you have some prayers to answer.
Yes, sir.
And it's not about none of your capabilities. Is about what happened on that cross. And because of what happened on that cross, Jesus is about to change circumstances when you stand fully and solely there. Amen?
Amen.
Give God praise. Amen. And give